Yes, that's a very common experience. Absolutely. For both men and women, an initial diagnosis is very overwhelming. And what a lot of couples will experience and individuals is that the sexual concern goes on a back burner. We see that really commonly, and that's totally appropriate. We usually have a very high priority around understanding our treatment options. We have a lot of emotions around a diagnosis of cancer, usually. And so if there is a room for opportunity at some of those earlier visits, usually the oncology care team, including the social workers, will have some conversation as we're talking through treatment options and what the benefits and potential consequences of cancer treatments are. That's usually the first introduction for a conversation. And sometimes we're just too consumed with thinking about the trajectory of the cancer to really think about our sexual function, and that's okay. So it's really very led, directed by an individual who's had that diagnosis. And we see not uncommonly that many men and women will have had sexual concerns or relationship concerns around intimacy prior to a cancer diagnosis. And then they find at a certain stage when they're through recovery that they may be kind of having trouble to before. It's now become more difficult as a consequence of the cancer. So usually we're picking up the pace on the sexual function side as it's appropriate. And we try to support oncology groups and teams to initiate that conversation when it's appropriate, because as you said, there's so many other things going on. It's not uncommon for that conversation to not be a priority, which is understandable. So we try to bring it up as frequently and as early and as often as we can, because it's very difficult for men and women to bring these topics up. And some of the treatments are, the cancer itself is not going to create a sexual dysfunction. It is the therapeutic process, either surgery or chemotherapy or radiation or hormone deprivation therapies that often may be ongoing for several years before someone starts to experience a sexual dysfunction. So it's, we try to screen as early as possible in the diagnostic and therapeutic process. But you're absolutely correct. Sometimes that sexual or intimate concern gets put on the back burner for a little bit. But what we see is that oftentimes couples will go kind of into a freeze where they're just trying to make it through that initial alarming, concerning process of like, well, how are we going to manage this? And then it gets pushed off. And we often will see couples 1 to 10 years down the road who really weren't ever able to reconnect into that intimate and sexual place after this huge disruption from the cancer process. So we try to provide that opportunity to talk as often as we can, knowing there's a lot else going on, because many couples will find that as they thaw, so to speak, that piece of their relationship has become very disrupted from the cancer process, but they're not really sure where to get resources or help. And because there are so many other things to talk about, it gets pushed to the wayside, which is why a lot of men and women are very frustrated and realize that things have changed and they don't know how to get back on track with each other. And so even though it's difficult to bring up, we strongly encourage people to bring these intimate concerns up to their team providers so that we can get resources on board sooner.